Quantic Media.
What is up, everybody? Batch of BirdMan here with part 2 of the Evolution of Battlefield series, featuring DICE's second game on console, Battlefield Bad Company 1. The video you are watching is the first glimpse the world got to see of Battlefield Bad Company 1. I remember finishing up a match on the Nest in Mountain Combat, and one of my buddies spamming me to go see the Bad Company 1 teaser, telling me, oh my god, dude, you're not even gonna believe how crazy Battlefield Bad Company 1 is. So I went, hopped on YouTube, and I watched it. Now, I remember watching it as if it was yesterday, but time flies and it was March 12, 2007. The whole teaser blew me away, but the part that really stuck to me was this.
Whoa, hold the phone here. You just said we can blow up anything?
Pretty much.
Anything?
Pretty much anything.
Now that is great news. Oh, hey, sorry, check this out. Number one! And we'll come down to one, two, come down to one.
A story of one man's journey.
After researching more in depth about Battlefield Bad Company 1, I found out destructible environments played a huge role in the game. I could just imagine. Playing in the Nest and being able to shoot a tank shell or anything at a building, instead of seeing a small smoke cloud, I would see realistic damage done to the structure. That being said, let me make it clear that the Bad Company series was completely new to the Battlefield games, introducing an entirely scripted campaign and a new revolutionary engine called Frostbite 1.0. It was pretty amazing, but it wasn't enough to make the game live up to its former glory. I distinctly recall the beautiful summer day of Battlefield Bad Company 1's release. After playing Battlefield 2 Modern Combat for 2.5 years, finally the big gap was filled. In my head, I expected the game to have at least the same features, if not more, as its predecessor. Unfortunately, I was terribly wrong. Bad Company 1 may have offered squads, improved graphics, better player movement, kit customization, iron sights, destruction, and lastly, considering Bad Company 1 quadrupled Modern Combat in sales, it brought a new generation of Battlefield players. But despite these pros, the transition into the Bad Company series was a perfect example of taking 4 steps forward and 2 steps back. During this comparison, I will be as unbiased as possible and try and keep my personal opinions to a bare minimum. We're gonna start off the evolution with the menus again. Going back to that beautiful day back on June 23rd, 2008, as soon as I got home, I popped in BC1 and went straight to the multiplayer. 5 things on the menu that were added, altered, or removed were squads, clan support, server browsing, ranks, and awards. To my surprise, I found 0 clan support. Unlike Modern Combat, BC1 didn't even feature private matches. The exclusion of clan support didn't bother me as much as the complete removal of server browsing. I no longer had the freedom of seeing all ongoing servers on the map I picked. Luckily, I could still pick the map I wanted to play, but without being able to see the info of the server, I was easily placed in a match that is almost over or empty. Another big change is when you join a match, you're automatically placed on one side. You're no longer allowed to pick the army you wanted to play for like in Modern Combat. The new matchmaking system we find today on console battlefields strips 80% of your freedoms away. I learned to deal with it, but I couldn't deal with the new and completely failed ranking system. It took only about 10% of the effort to reach the highest rank compared to Modern Combat, and after I reached the highest rank in less than 24 hours of gameplay, I found myself with 0 motivation to keep my score per minute up, because the demotion feature was completely taken out. But despite these 3 surprising and mindless changes, Bad Company 1 improved greatly on some aspects of the menu. The award system was larger and more elaborate than Modern Combat's, but without a doubt, the greatest new innovation was creating a squad and joining a match with friends. In Modern Combat, you had to join a match, invite your friend, and pray that your team or the game didn't fill up before you joined. These changes were either for the better or the worse, but the biggest addition Battlefield Bad Company 1 brought to the Battlefield series was the new game mode known as Gold Rush. What really shocked me was that Gold Rush was the only multiplayer mode in the initial release of Battlefield Bad Company 1. Considering the main focus of single player campaign was collecting gold, the basis of Gold Rush was attacking gold crates and defending them. The day one Gold Rush maps were Harvest Day, Over and Out, End of the Line, Ascension, Valley Run, Deconstruction, Final Ignition, and lastly, Oasis. Although the 8 Gold Rush maps on Battlefield Bad Company 1 were gigantic in size and length, the Gold Rush game mode confined you to a limited battlefield until the crates were destroyed. Finally, after a month and a half of DICE shoving Gold Rush down our throats, the Conquest game mode returned to Bad Company on August 7th, 2008. It returned to us in a free Conquest map pack that included size down and modified Gold Rush maps Ascension, End of the Line, Oasis, and lastly, Harvest Day. These 4 maps were fun, but weren't that special. They were literally sized down Gold Rush maps we already had. Luckily, 2.5 months later on October 31st, 2008, another free Conquest map pack was released. This map pack included 4 new maps from single player featuring Actonon Verba, Ghost Town, Par for the Course, and Crossing Over. So with all that being said, it took 4.5 months to get a total of 12 unique maps. But let's compare this to Battlefield 2 Modern Combat and see how things evolved. Battlefield 2 Modern Combat came packed with 2 game modes, Conquest and Capture the Flag. In total, there were 16 unique maps, and every single one of them was playable on both modes. All of this was included on day 1 of Modern Combat's release, meaning Battlefield Bad Company 1 came with half the maps and half the game modes. Also, Battlefield 2 Modern Combat had 4 different armies, United States, China, Middle Eastern Coalition, and the European Union. In Battlefield Bad Company 1, USA and the Middle Eastern Coalition remained, while China and the EU were taken out and replaced by the Russian army. But the transition to Bad Company 1 didn't just include less maps and different armies, it altered the kit loadouts as well. But quickly, before we go over the kits, I want to talk about one great addition Battlefield Bad Company 1 included. This game incorporated different weapon stats for all the guns, unlike Modern Combat, which had 0 stats whatsoever. But going back to the kits, I'm going to talk about how they evolved from Battlefield 2 Modern Combat to Bad Company 1. First, we're going to go over the assault kit. It includes an assault rifle, grenade launcher, frag grenades, and an auto ejector. The weapons and gadget you can use in this kit are the AEK-91, the M416, the AUG, the AN-94, the F2000, the M16, the XM8, a 40mm grenade launcher, and a Life 2 auto ejector. Compared to Modern Combat, this class was mostly unchanged, except for the smoke grenade being replaced with the auto ejector, which is a personal self-healing tool. In terms of evolution with weapon design and sound, I'm going to compare the M4 in Modern Combat to the M416 in BC1. Second, we're going to go over the recon kit. It includes a sniper rifle, a pistol, motion sensing bulbs, and a laser designator. The weapons and gadgets you could utilize with this class are the SU-98, the M24, the GOL, the VSS, the QBU-88, the SVU, the M95, and the LZ-537 laser designator. Compared to Modern Combat, the sniper loadout was now called the recon kit. The class remained mostly the same, the only differences were the silenced pistol turned into a standard unsilenced pistol, and the GPS evolved into motion sensing bulbs. In terms of evolution with weapon design and sound, I'm going to compare the laser designator of Modern Combat to the laser designator in BC1. The third kit we're going to go over is the Specialist. It includes a submachine gun, tracer darts, frag grenades, and C4s. The weapons and gadgets you have on this class are the 9A91, the SCAR, the AK-74U, the XMA Compact, the Uzi, the UMP-45, the PP-2000, and lastly C4 explosives. In terms of evolution with weapon design and sound, I'm going to compare the UMP from Modern Combat to the UMP in Bad Company 1.
This thing on your own, son? Try waiting for the rest of your squad.
The fourth class we're gonna go over is called Demolition. It has a shotgun, frag grenades, rocket launcher, and landmines. The weapons and gadgets that apply to this class are the S-20K, the 870 MCS, the T-194, the SPAS-15, the USAS-12, the SPAS-12, the NS-2000, anti-tank mines, the AP-4, RPG-7, and lastly the M2 Carl Gustav. Compared to Modern Combat, the Engineer class turned into the Demolition loadout. In Modern Combat, the class was practically the same. The only change was the Blowtorch repair tool was switched with frag grenades. I'm going to compare the RPG-7 in Modern Combat to the RPG-7 in Back to 1. Last but not least, the support class. It includes a light machine gun, med kits, mortar strike, and a power drill repair tool. The weapons and gadgets that the support has are the PKM, the M249 saw, the JQU88, the MG3, the M60, the XM8 light machine gun, the MG36, and the mortar strike. Comparing this to Modern Combat, the loadout was slightly changed and modified. The auto ejector in Modern Combat was switched with a med kit, and the grenades were swapped with a power repair tool. So now we're going to move on to the vehicles. Bad Company 1 featured a total of 18, which is slightly over half of the vehicles Modern Combat offered us, considering Modern Combat had a total of 35. So out of 18 vehicles, 3 of them were battle tanks. The M1A2 Abrams, the Black Eagle, and the T-90. Also there were light tanks, the M3A3 Bradley, the BMD-3, and the T-2 Stalker. Unessentially, we got 5 light transport vehicles. The Vodnik, the Cobra, the Humvee, the Cav, and my favorite, the Golf Cart. What disappointed me the most with the lack of vehicles was the fact that there was only 3 helicopters. The AH-64 Apache, the Mi-28 Havoc, and the Ka-52 Alligator. But moving on, we had 1 naval vehicle. There was the patrol boat. Lastly, the stationaries were the Zu-23-2 AA, the TOW missile, and the artillery strike. So starting with the main battle tanks, the Leopard 2A5 in Modern Combat was replaced with the Black Eagle, the Type 98 was removed, while the Abrams and the T-90 remained. As for the light tanks, the Shilko was removed, the BMD-3 was kept, the M6 Linebacker was replaced by the Bradley, and the BMP-2 was switched for the 2T Stalker. Next we have the light transport vehicles. The Humvee remained, while the DPV, Eagle MTV, the FAV, the Krep, and both civilian cars and snowmobile were removed and replaced by the Vodnik, the Cobra, the Cav, and the Golf Cart. Moving on, we have the helicopters. Of course, the AH-64 Apache was kept, the Mi-24 Hind was replaced by the Mi-28 Havoc, the WZ-9 was swapped for the Ka-52 Alligator, but unfortunately, the AH-6J Little Bird and the Black Hawk were removed. Finally, the stationaries. The artillery strike was altered, the JTAM in Modern Combat was replaced by the Zu-23-2 AA, and the Jills 87 was switched for the TOW missile. To give you a good interpretation of how the vehicles evolved, I'm going to compare and contrast the Abrams, the BMD-3, the Humvee, the Apache, the patrol boat, and the artillery strike. Starting off with the Abrams, the general design was the same, but the physics and movement were slightly different. In Modern Combat, the Abrams was faster and had a more fluid movement compared to Bad Company 1's Abrams, which was sluggish but had a very realistic tread movement. The effectiveness was also different. In Modern Combat, the Abrams tank shell was ridiculously fast with a zero gravity drop and extremely deadly to all vehicles and human targets. The BC-1 Abrams had a visible and slower tank shell with the gravity drop that was very effective against vehicles but weaker against human soldiers. As for the BMD-3, the design was greatly improved. In Modern Combat, the BMD had a greater max speed and responsive controls compared to Bad Company 1's BMD, which had abrupt acceleration and a swaying movement. In both games, these light tanks were very effective against vehicles and human players, but the BMD-3 in Modern Combat was extra effective against vehicles because of the mounted rocket launcher. Next we have the Humvee. The design was identical in both games, but physics and movement were greatly altered. The Humvee in Modern Combat was faster and made sharper turns compared to the awkward slow speeds and handling Bad Company 1 had. In both Modern Combat and BC-1, the Humvee was an effective vehicle to transport players into battle. Moving on to the Apache, the design was unchanged, but when it came down to the physics and vehicle movement, it was a completely different story. In Modern Combat, the Apache had a very slow descent speed along with a sensitive agility factor, as if the helicopter was rotating on a spherical axis. Compared to Bad Company, the physics were greatly improved. The BC-1 Apache had a fluid agility, which made it easier to control and aim rockets. Although the max speed was roughly the same as in Modern Combat, the descent rate was greatly increased. In every Battlefield title, a skilled, experienced pilot can possibly determine the outcome of a match. In Modern Combat, the Apache was effective with its deadly rockets, but was countered with challenging physics and heat-seeking JTAMs. In Bad Company 1, the rockets were still effective against vehicles and players, but their damage was reduced. Due to the fact that the Apache was so much easier to fly, the JTAMs were replaced by anti-airs, and the new gunner seat featuring a 30mm explosive bullet chain gun replaced the old ridiculously weak Gatling-style gunner seat in Modern Combat. Now let's talk about the patrol boat. The general design was completely revised. The physics and movement of the patrol boat in Modern Combat feels as if you're gliding on ice with very sensitive controls. In Bad Company 1, the patrol boat has a very realistic feel to it and has much more resistant controls. The effectiveness of these boats are very similar. Both boats are very fast and are a good form of transport. Lastly, the artillery strike. The design was immensely altered. Instead of a small satellite uplink style crate in Modern Combat, Dice remade it into a huge cannon. Considering this is a stationary, physics and movement don't apply. In Modern Combat, the artillery strike dropped a massive payload of explosive ordnance over a large area, leaving no survivors, and was available every 5 minutes after a player used it. The Bad Company 1 artillery used a computer grid-style aiming system, and it fired a mere 5 shots and was usable again after 20 seconds. Personally, I believe that Modern Combat had a more adequate artillery. Although it was more powerful and covered a larger area, at least I didn't have mortar strikes dropping over my head every 20 seconds while I was confined to a small certain area defending gold crates. Well, that finishes off the evolution of some of the vehicles. Now, I'm briefly going to cover some other small changes Battlefield Bad Company 1 introduced. In Modern Combat, the player movement looked as if you were gliding, but thanks to Frostbite 1, the player movement became very realistic. On the other side of realism, you were able to go prone in Modern Combat, whereas in Bad Company 1, that was impossible. This was balanced with the addition of sprinting, which you couldn't do in Modern Combat. Another difference was that in Modern Combat, vehicles had a limited amount of ammunition, while Bad Company 1 had unlimited ammo. But a big improvement visually in Bad Company 1 is that now the outline of the maps was fogged out or covered with giant landscape. This was a problem in ISOR in Modern Combat, where you could clearly see where the map cuts off. Lastly, I understand Battlefield is known for its realism, but when that interferes with convenience and fun, there's a problem. Bad Company 1 was the only Battlefield that did not feature a parachute. Although Bad Company 1 had its defects, they didn't stop it from taking the Battlefield series to the next level. While the competition was continuously releasing the same repolished content, Battlefield was evolving, forever changing the way the game was played and created. This concludes part 2 of the series. I hope you guys were entertained and maybe even learned a thing or two. Please give some feedback in the comments below, give this video the rating you think it deserves, and subscribe for much more Battlefield content. Be sure to check out Kingman's channel, because none of this would have been possible without him. Thanks for all the support. See you on part 3. Peace out.